So before we get into HIV and CRISPR, I've seen many of my friends getting confused with these two words. What is HIV? What is CRISPR? Or what is AIDS? So they are just correlated to each other, but they're not synonymous to each other. HIV is human immunodeficiency virus, which is causing, which affects the immune system of the body, and it causes immunodeficiency. And these complications, which are caused by the HIV virus, is called as AIDS, which is acquired immunodeficiency syndrome. And now let's see how it enters into our body and what it does. So here we can see this is the HIV virus. On its outer membrane, we can see there's something called as GP120 protein. So what this does is it attaches to the CD4 molecules, which are present on T cells and also some sentinel cells like macrophages, monocytes, and dendritic cells. So with the help of one GP120 protein, it attaches to the CD4 molecule, which is present on the outer surface of the cell. And with the help of one more GP120 protein, with the help of one more GP120 protein, it attaches to a coreceptor, which can be CCR5 or CXCR5. So after this gets attached, it goes inside. But this process should happen for it to go inside. We have heard that there are many people who are resistant to HIV. That's because they have some homozygous or heterozygous mutations in these receptors. So that's why this HIV can't enter inside the cell. Once the people who are not resistant to this mechanism will take place and it'll enter inside the cell, not the whole virus, but just the RNA of that virus. Then by using reverse transcriptase, it becomes the proviral DNA and integrates the host DNA. Now let's see what are the symptoms, and I'll tell that by using this graph, the blue line indicates the HIV in the blood and the green line indicates the number of T cells. So once the person gets infected due to this HIV, first he'll be having some flu-like symptoms or mononucleosis-like symptoms, which is the acute infection. In this period of time, there'll be increase in the HIV virus. So there'll be decrease in the T helper cells because it's mainly affecting the T helper cells. But then our body realizes there's something wrong with our body. Then it starts counterattacking. So at that particular time, there'll be increase in T helper cells and decrease in HIV virus. But we should remember that it has already integrated its DNA to the host DNA. So whenever there is an immune response, there'll be replication of that DNA with the host DNA, and translation, transcription, everything takes place. So the period where it will be asymptomatic will be decrease in the HIV virus and increase in the T helper cells. After that, the person gets into the chronic period, which lasts from 2 to 10 years. So during this time, already the HIV would have replicated so much, so there will be increase in HIV and decrease in the T cells, which is called as falling count, symptomatic or opportunistic infection, and then it will be the final crisis. We know there are many treatments for HIV, like antiretroviral drug therapy, and recently there was a vaccination which eradicated total HIV in monkeys. Maybe in future we might have it, but genetic engineering has found out a better treatment for this. But before we get into it, let's refresh our memory about genes. What is a gene? It's nothing but basic unit of heredity or alphabets of DNA. Genetic engineering, it's nothing but some modifications or manipulations which can be done in the genetic sequence. We all know about the GMO foods, like that's why we are getting seedless fruits and crops are resistant to particular seasons, and even during all season we are getting all the types of exotic fruits. And not to mention about the Dolly the sheep, which was the first mammal to be cloned using the adult stem cells. So now coming to the main topic, which is CRISPR. What is CRISPR? It's nothing but clustered, regularly interspaced, short palindromic repeats. I know this is too big like my name, but where did this originate from? This was from the oldish war which was happening between the bacteria and the virus. We all know viruses are stronger, and every time there was a fight between the bacteria and virus, bacteria used to lose and virus used to win. But one day bacteria realized that it's intelligent enough and it can fight back. So that's the time this mechanism started. What it did was, when the bacteriophage comes to attack the bacteria, it used to take the DNA material from the virus using some Cas proteins and integrate it to its own DNA, and produce some copies, some photocopies, and give it to a police officer So next time the police officer sees these copies, he'll go and catch it. So that mechanism, I've explained it here. It's nothing but the police officer here is the Cas9 protein. They'll be having the copy, which is nothing but the RNA. And this RNA is transcribed by the genetic material, which was introduced into the CRISPR. Now let's see how can this be used in genetic engineering and how can this happen. Previously we saw in bacteria, it was producing its own guide RNA. But when we are using this in genetic engineering, the scientists prepare a guide RNA, which sequences the DNA, which should be damaged. So after the Cas9 proteins with RNA enters the cell, it damages the cell, it damages the DNA sequence. So now what will happen? There is a damage. So there should be a reparation process. There are usually two types of reparation process. One is the known homology and joining. That's just very easy. So once there's a DNA damage, what will happen? They'll just, like, two ends are there. So they'll just tie up each other. That's it. But if the two ends are there, we find that there is already total missing of one sequence. So there'll be a total missing of one sequence, which might cause some genetic mutations or some complications. That's when scientists realize with the Cas9 protein and the guide RNA, they also sent a template. So after the damage is done, after the deletion is done, so they can insert this and there'll be no mutations or any other complications. And that is called as the homology recombination type of repair. So how this is used in HIV? This is the module which was given by Jennifer. Dr. Jennifer, who is the co-inventor of CRISPR, in a conference. The one which is in white color, we can see that's the Cas9 protein, and it carries the guide RNA, that's in the orange color, and the DNA is in the blue color. So what's the main goal of using this in HIV treatment? The main goal is to remove the HIV genome from the normal human genome, and mainly to eradicate the reservoirs of HIV virus, which is not being able to be done by the antiretroviral therapy. And also to inherit this trait to the offspring so that even they become resistant to HIV and there'll be total eradication. So how can this be done? There'll be two ways. If it's in the embryonic stage, like during the pregnancy, the mother gets to know the baby is going to be affected by HIV, then they can do some damage to the sequence in the CCR5 or CXCR4 receptors so that the HIV can't bind and get inside. But what if the person is already affected by this? Then they'll create a guide RNA which sequences this proviral DNA. So once that goes inside, it'll damage the proviral DNA. And even the RNA is damaged, which is produced by that, because they have the same sequences. And even the viral proteins will also be destroyed. So there'll be total clearance of HIV here. So there were actually many experiments conducted on this to see what are the results and what are the complications and all. One of the main experiments was there were four rats, humanized rats taken. They were infected with HIV virus and they actually showed the same response as the humans. Like they have the same immune system type as the humans. That's why it was conducted on this humanized rats. The first one, there was no treatment given to this. And the second one, we used CRISPR-Cas9 technology. And the third one, we used laser rat. That's nothing but antiretroviral drug therapy. And the fourth one, we combined both this laser rat and CRISPR-Cas9. So we found a better results in CRISPR-Cas9 and combining this. In laser rat, there was a good results, but there was not total clearance of this HIV virus. But there was the person was feeling better and he was asymptomatic in this period. And recently, the scientist named He Joan Koo, he also tried this CRISPR-Cas9 technology on real human embryos. Like the twins, Lulu and Nana, were born HIV negative and his father was positive, but they were born HIV negative. What he did was he made the changes in the CCR5 receptor and CXCR4 receptors so that the HIV, it can't come inside, can't bind and come inside. That's how we eradicated the HIV virus in these twins. So as I told before about the combination of using antiretroviral drugs and CRISPR-Cas9 technology, that showed the best results. That's because only when CRISPR-Cas9 was introduced, it was very difficult for it to clear the HIV virus because there was intense replication of this virus taking place. So they thought first they'll prescribe antiretroviral drugs so that will decrease the replication of this HIV virus. And then after a few days, they'll put this CRISPR-Cas9 technology so that it'll be very easy for CRISPR-Cas9 to destroy all the viral RNA, DNA, and the proteins. And that'll be the total eradication of this HIV virus. And this showed the best results there. I know it sounds so interesting and there are like many advantages. Like we can see we can eradicate HIV, many genetical disorders, even we can reverse aging and also like prevent and cure cancer and everything. But what are these disadvantages? If this is told as it's very easy and cheap. So if it becomes so easy and easily available and cheap, people will start misusing it. That's like humans are never satisfactory. They want to be the best. So they want everything. So they might start misusing it or using it for their own conveniences. Maybe in future we can see some advertisements like this, buy two modifications and get one free, or a person who loves to fly can modify himself to fly in the air, or the person who loves to swim can modify his legs as web feet and swim, or we can even modify the babies, future babies, and that will be so easy. Like as we modify or customize our birthday cakes, it will be so easy like that. If it becomes so easy, then people will start misusing, and maybe we might erase the human race at the end. So, like at last, like I would like to conclude. Before implementing this CRISPR, we already have many questions. So first, that should be answered. Like questions like, because this is an artificial process, what will be these effects? Will there be any side effects in long-term usage, or are there any complications because of using this? So first, we have to know the answers for all these questions, and then it should be implemented. I like this quote which was told by Professor Jennifer. The more we know, the more we realize there is to know. Yeah, medicine is like ocean of knowledge. There is so much to know, and there is no end for that. And at last, I would like to tell, in future, if this gets implemented, this should be used wisely, and it should contain some set of ethical rules. So this should not be misused or used for our own convenience. It should be only used only when it's needed. And these are my references.